Welcome, everyone. So I'm very excited to be with you today at the State of the University. This is my first one, so I had to follow a lot of instructions from the team to tell me what I'm supposed to do, and hopefully I'll do okay. So I hope that you had an opportunity to read the written report. And also, I cherish the opportunities of having listening sessions with all the different constituencies of the university. And today we're going to do this in a little bit differently. This is a big year. We're celebrating 50 years in Bristol. And this is how the campus used to look 50 years ago. And so a lot of wonderful things have happened, and a lot more wonderful things will follow. I want to thank Mel Topf. Is Mel here today? Because he's the one that brought to my attention that this is a very important year, the 50th year, and thank you for that. And we have a fabulous publication that our marketing and communication folks put together, and we have a copy for each one of you to take. It's a very nice publication, featuring what has happened the last 50 years and giving an insight of what's going to happen in the future. So, building the university the world needs now, it's the phrase that attracted me to this university, and I talked to you a little bit about that when I first came. There could be a lot of ways that this could be interpreted. What attracted me the most is that first, universities have to adapt and change. I saw that Roger Williams has all the potential to adapt and change, and also has all the right ingredients in place to truly become such a university. Now, as you know, we ran a survey, and not everybody was in agreement with this statement. This is a comment that we get. Can we stop pretending that we are or ever will be the university the world needs now? It's embarrassingly presumptive. And there is one model for what university should be, and that little under-resourced Roger Williams University thinks that it knows what the world needs. I sort of sympathize with that statement. However, I still feel that we have all it takes to become the university the world needs now. But it will take all of us to work together and to figure out how we're going to do that. So today's remarks will start off the state of the university and go by division by division. However, I believe you read the report, and so I'm not going to go into great detail. I want to focus more on goals for the year and use the results of the survey as a basis of my comments. And then we'll have a Q&A. So we had 212 respondents on the campus survey, which was good but not terrific. I would love to have everybody respond to the survey. We got a huge amount of excellent information. All the cabinet has read them. I have read them one by one, kept a lot of notes, and these are going to be helping us with the strategic planning process as a guide moving forward. These are the different categories, and I don't know if you can read the slide here, and I'll read some of them, that we got responses. The largest percent of comments, questions were about academics. The second one was diversity and equity. Third was morale, fiscal health, vision, strategic planning, Roger Williams problems, student body, distinctiveness, it goes down. So you get an idea of what the areas that we got responses were focused on. Most questions, as I said, are about academics. And diversity and equity. Diversity and equity in a broader sense, comments about diversity and equity, racial diversity, but also pay equity, treatment by others, acceptable treatment that some of our colleagues experience, and things like that. When we map the most popular words, this is how the map worked. Academics was biggest. Leadership comments were about restrictive culture, disconnected leadership, top-down styles, too many administrators. On the morale side, there was no safe place to report, do a lot more with a lot less, treatment, how we treat each other, silos, divides. So these are the comments in this area. And none of this surprised me, and I'm sure none of this surprised you. What brings pride? Dedication was the number one. There's no question that faculty and staff care about our students, and you can see the other areas as well. So I'm on my 66th day, I'm not counting today, and I'm still new, but I'm sure there are some other people that are new this year. Who is new this year? Can you please stand? All right, welcome. Welcome. So, the written report went out. There is one area that I think we should boost next year, was the area about the academics and the faculty achievements. And one change we'll make next year was we'll have a portions of the report from the different schools. So every school, the faculty and the dean will provide us information of highlights of what happened in the different schools. This has not happened in the past, but I strongly feel this should be part of the reporting in the future. Now, focusing on academic student success, we did very well this year. We had the class of 2018, we had 84.9% first to second year retention, which was up 3.8%. And basically, we had 40 more students enrolling this fall because of that. In the class of 2017, you can see the numbers on the screen, we had about 27 students that were retained. So it was amazing that all the university worked together, the academic advisors, the deans, and to support the students, because not only it was wonderful for the students, but also financially it makes a big difference for us, about $1.3 million additional revenue by us managing to retain these students. By the way, when you see the little yellow icon on the bottom, this is a question that came from a response that came from the survey. So that's what the yellow icon. So this is directly from a survey. What roles do flexibility, innovation, and alternative paths to learning play in the changing role of higher education? So I'm a fan of trying different programs, and you saw right away we made some changes. We changed the children policy, we changed the dog policy. And I'm all for trying and experimenting different things and piloting, and if they work, we continue, or if not, as we expected, we adapt them and we improve them. And however, we have to become more nimble and faster. For example, the curriculum approval process, I've heard from many people it takes way too long, and faculty are hesitant to even propose new programs because they don't want to go through this whole process. Well, that's something that the faculty can change, and we'll be happy to help from administration, but it's a faculty issue. And experimenting and changing things is how we're going to become the university the world needs now. Again, like as I mentioned, how can we make the curriculum process less frustrating? It's a faculty issue, so we'll be happy to help the faculty to change the process. And it should change. It should not change. Take years to go through things that could be decided in a couple of weeks or 3 weeks. So that's an area that faculty is supposed to work on it, and we'll be happy to help. I would be happy to get involved personally. I'm an academic also, if you think I could offer something in this area. There were some questions on professional versus liberal arts programs, and this is addressed to me. Your background is in applied science, as you see it. What is valuable about college majors and programs in the humanities and social sciences? Well, one of my degrees is in economics, so I do have some economics background. But what attracted me to my college, Tufts, when I went to Tufts, was exactly because combined professional education with very strong liberal arts. And I think that a well-educated person, regardless what their focus is, should have grounding in humanities and social sciences as well. And Roger Williams has all the components to do that. And so that's sort of how I feel about liberal arts. I think liberal arts are an essential component of Roger Williams, not only to support students in other professional schools, but also to generate their own graduates and thinkers and scholars in these areas. Another question, comment, looking at the place of the liberal arts and the professional schools moving forward, Where should resources be focused? There are programs that are and have been at very low enrollments for long periods of time. Does it make any sense for the university to continue to offer these? This will be part of our planning process. Yes, there are some programs, not only in liberal arts, but also in professional schools that are small, and we should take a look at them. There are some that are large, but they're so expensive to run that we should look at them as well. So this is part of the planning process that will take place this year. Strategies how to get the university to bring different disciplines to collaborate to solve society's problems. There are a lot of silos here, and when I talk about silos, people assume it's the Bristol versus University College. There are a lot more silos within Bristol. Schools that should be working together don't work together, and departments that should be working together don't work together, and of course the biggest issue now is bringing the University College and Bristol campus together. And in that spirit, we are planning a University College showcase. It's going to be on November 15th. I'll be there. It's 9:30 to 12 o'clock, where you come and meet people to learn all about University College. It's open to the entire community here, and I hope it will well attend it. University College offers a number of great programs. These are some pathways here you can see. And some of you may be surprised that the school serves, the University College serves about half the number of students that Bristol serves here. 2,654 students last year. So it's a big deal. It's not a small place out there in Providence. And you can see the breakdown of various constituencies in the school. Around University College vision, what do you see for the future of University College as it pertains to working with high schools and adult learners? What is my vision? So this is a vision that we'll all create together. James is a terrific visionary and leader of the school, but it's something that as we bring the two campuses closer together, we should create, the vision should be created together. And already great things are happening. The whole higher education is changing. Not everybody goes to college now. Not everybody goes to four-year college. When I went to college, it was sort of the expected path, but now there are many different ways that students see higher education, and we have an amazing tool for us to deliver for the traditional students here in Bristol, but the non-traditional students in Providence through the University College. I only have one slide from the School of Law because there weren't any questions or problems with the School of Law. So thank you. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Dean Ilonowski, for all the amazing things you have done for the school. Just a couple of things. The first, second year retention is 94.4% at the law school. So attrition is just 5.6%, which is amazing. And there is $500,000 endowment for the Pro Bono Collaborative. This is the program where our law students help folks in Providence on legal issues. And he built an amazing faculty. Women make up 63.3% of the faculty at the law school. So the diversity of the student body and the faculty is just terrific. And we are beginning the search for a new dean, and we identified a search firm, and I'll talk about more, a little bit more about that. So we're ready to roll. There are many more questions about Jerry Williams, by the way, so now we have many slides. So I have many slides about Jerry. So, actually, there are questions not about Jerry, but about finance and budget. So we started last year with a significant projected gap between revenue and expenditures, and we ended the year with actually a modest surplus, and that's because of all the good work you did in reducing expenses. And the problem we had was this the frozen tuition issue, where we had frozen tuition for many years and expenses kept going up and up and up, so it was a not sustainable model. Again, if you have four enrolled classes with no incremental revenue, this puts pressure on the headcount, puts pressure to reduce expenses, and however, we managed to go through it, and we expect that every year from now on is gonna be better and better because of the changes we made this year. The good news also is the university has reduced its debt, from 140 million to 2011 to under 100 million. And Jerry has been very creative in refinancing our debt and has saved the university millions and millions of dollars for doing so. We just went through a process recently for that. So we are changing the pricing model, still keeping affordability as a priority for us. And also we are looking to increase diversity of our revenue because I think we have cut as much as we could cut. So now we have to look at additional revenue for new money. Also because of the financial situation at the university, the budgeting process was upside down. You first do the budget, then you plan. And now we're gonna change that to first plan and then figure out the budget. So we're going to have a plan in place, hopefully in May, and then from now on we'll start planning the budget accordingly. So there would be a number of fiscal update meetings. I know you've had enough of transition years, but this again has to be a transition year because we don't have the strategic action plan in place ready. But nonetheless, we have to have a budget for next year. And so there will be, between now and January, divisional meetings, faculty senate meetings, and meetings with other entities. And we will present the fiscal update, and we'll talk about the different budget elements at the smaller meetings. So try to attend as many of these meetings as you can. So another comment from the survey, what is the general financial health of the university? After 2 years of austerity, when will the budgets be restored to normal so we can provide to our students what we owe them? And as I said, we are trying to diversify and expand the revenue. And we want to offer the students what they deserve. And again, thank you for reducing expenses so far, and we need all your creative thoughts for increasing revenue. Now, this is our campus. Currently, we are in the process of finalizing our campus master plan, and the plan is still evolving. I went to one meeting I would go on a Tuesday to a meeting, look at the master plan, and thinking that this is how it's going to look, and then I'll go to a next meeting on the master plan the next day, and the buildings would have been moved around. So it's still in progress. I can give you a quick preview of the thinking because I think it's very exciting. So this is what it is now. This is the current plan. And in orange are new or significant renovated dormitory spaces. And the lower part of the campus will focus on first year students. And then as you move up, you'll be more upperclassmen. The dormitories will include spaces for academic components also, so we want to bring closer academics with residential life. And as you see, the dark blue buildings are planned expansions or new buildings for academics. And we see an expanded science building. And where the administration building now, you see another blue building that could house could be a new building for the business school, or it's still not determined yet. Then the other long, funky building close to the dormitories on the closer to the bottom of the screen there could be a visual arts building, moving some of the athletics further on the upper side of the campus and allowing for more parking at that place. So these are some of the elements of the master plan, but it's not ready for full disclosure yet, because still they're going through many iterations. But that's to give you a view of how things like a lot less cars driving around campus, a lot more walking, and much more pleasant areas for students and faculty and staff to walk and enjoy the beautiful setting we have here. And Bill Seymour has been championing this process from our end. Enrollment management, new first year enrollment is up 7% from the fall, and new graduate enrollment is 6.5% above goal. So we're doing pretty well. And I know this has been an all staff and faculty effort. Let me have the ones of you that have participated at an open house, or accepted student day, or made calls, or attended off-campus events, or other things related to attracting students here. Can you please stand? Well, you see, it's a lot of people are involved with that, so thank you. Okay. On target demographics, what type of student are we hoping to attract to Roger Williams? Students from rigorous academic backgrounds, students who need remediation in multiple areas. The wonderful thing about this place is that it can be a place for all kinds of students. We have the parent advisory group. I don't know if that's the exact title. Is that, Lisa, is the parent advisory group? This is much more complicated than parent advisory group. So nonetheless, we have a parent advisory group with a longer name. And I met with them. And what surprised me is that more than half of these parents were parents actually of alums, not parents of students, that they enjoyed so much and they appreciated so much the experience the students had on this campus that they continued being involved and contributing to the school. And half of these parents had students that had learning disabilities, that had trouble in high school, but Roger Williams was a place that made them flourish. And now they have either terrific graduate programs or they have terrific jobs. And so Roger Williams does a wonderful job on students that have learning challenges. Also, Roger Williams offers great opportunities for students that are very well prepared for college and at the higher end of the spectrum of potential accomplishment here. Can we do a better job? Yes, and I think we should talk about serving better, although we do have a great honors program, serving even better the students so we can retain them here. And there are many areas that we could invest in, like faculty, sponsoring faculty to boost undergraduate research and programs as such. Next question, competition. How will Roger Williams continue to attract students as the projected college age student population decreases? How are we doing compared to our competitors? So our competitors are not standing still. Some of them are competing with money. Some of them compete with programs. Some of them with prestige, with name. Again, we have all the ingredients to make this place special. I do not think we take advantage of everything we have to differentiate ourselves. When I was at the commencement last year, I was looking at the program, and I noticed that there are only very few students that either had completed a thesis or were close of completing a thesis. I think that could be a program, for example, we should boost, because one of the advantages of coming to a school like Roger Williams that doesn't have a big graduate program is the opportunity that students have with the faculty to work one-on-one on creating new knowledge or new art or depending on the discipline. And I think we should be doing a lot more of that, because students could pick Roger Williams versus a more research-oriented institution simply because of this faculty contact that they have. Student life. The care of our students is remarkable here. I have been very impressed. And it's a safe environment and a great community. And we have great, we don't have great dormitory facilities. I think this should be one of the biggest priorities for under the master plan. But we have great food. Actually, we're ranked one of the 20th best dining in country. And it's all about good food and well-being. And I, whenever I have a chance, I go and I eat with the students in the commons, and the food is incredible. And I always say it's going to be the freshman 15 and the president 60. You know what I'm talking about. Diversity and inclusion. Under Ahmed's leadership, wonderful things are happening. We have programs to support students. Oops, I'm sorry, am I going? Yes. Students to improve retention and also to improve enrollment. And as you can see, the numbers are going up in a positive way. Also, we have employee support programs, the women's affinity groups. And I had the opportunity to participate in some of the listening sessions in the beginning. And actually, the new children policy was a result from this listening session that we just launched. We have the Intercultural University for staff, and the Leadership Academy that we're launching, I believe, next week. So lots of efforts and lots of emphasis that have started producing results. So this is supposed to be a secret because it's going to be announced today, tomorrow. The Providence Business News is giving us one of their awards for diversity and inclusion. And congratulations to Amé and all her effort. And to all the faculty and staff that have participated in that. So not only we are doing great things in this area for our students, our faculty and staff, but also now the community starts noticing it, which is wonderful because by being out there as one of the leaders in this area, we'll attract more diversity to the campus, which is exactly what we want. Advancement. Lisa, for many years, has been doing a fantastic job with very, very little in bringing resources to the university. She decided to leave us, much to my chagrin, to go to a new venture, and some of you have talked to her, so you know what it's all about. She's a Bristolian, so I'm trying every single way to keep her involved with the university, and I think I'm going to be successful. And also in recognition of all the amazing work she did for the sailing program as one of many things, they named the boat Lelisa Joy in honor of her. Unfortunately, it wasn't a cruise ship, but it's a start. So advancement raised over $3.5 million in new gifts and pledge payments last year, and the fiscal 19 represented the best fundraising year also for the law school. With Lisa's departure, we want to boost the already great staff that is in place there. So we're bringing a new leader, Amy Berkeley, to work with Lisa together in the beginning and then take over the division. I've known Amy for years, and she's a fantastic fundraiser, and she will work with our team there to do great, great things. This division, as many other divisions, has been hit a lot budgetarily. Just to give you an idea, the travel budget for the whole division of advancement is $4,500. If you go to two trips, it's gone. So how on earth can these people fundraise for alums in California and in Texas or qualify people? So the whole budget for stewardship is taking care of donors and to make sure they stay engaged with the university, $2,500. At the museum, I used to spend that much for a dinner with donors. Not a single donor, but bring donors, a few donors and have the food and have the people to help. This is, so, and people expect that. Because our donors are donors to a lot of other places. And people give to success. People believe it or not. Look at Harvard. Does Harvard need another $20 billion in its endowment? The biggest gifts go to Harvard because people want to give to a place that's successful, raises a lot of money. And so we have to invest in this area, and we'll do so. Another question. Recognizing that Roger William University's endowment is not as large as it needs to be, and given President Miaoulis' experience with institutional development, what does he think is a realistic goal for the endowment, and over what period of time could the goal be achieved? We need to have a campaign. We're far from a campaign. You have to have enough people in place that would contribute significantly so a campaign would not become an embarrassment. And we have some alums and some donors that are very philanthropic, but we really have to build a culture of philanthropy. We have an alumni council with dedicated alums. The average ones from the alumni council, the leadership group gives $70 a year. We have a lot of work to do to change this. So we are going to have a campaign. We're going to raise money for the university, for capital projects, and for endowment. We need that. And it's going to take time, and it's going to take each one of us working together. It's not going to be just my job or Amy's job or Christine's job. It's going to be all of us have to work on it. I'm not saying you have to go and ask you individually people for money, but the experience students have, the experience alums have, parents have, all this is significant of how people give to the university. And we moved the marketing and communications to the president's office, so we can do institutional branding, as well as still focusing on attracting new students here. And we're going to boost the advancement division, but we're going to rebuild the board of trustees and all work together to make this whole thing happen. Goals for the year ahead. So we're going to develop a strategic action plan. One of the best moves I made this year is to move Brian to the chief of staff position. He has done an amazing job, not only helping with everything else during my first 66 days, and a lot has happened during these 66 days. A lot of the credit goes to Brian, but also Brian is going to help us manage the whole strategic action plan. It's not going to be Brian's plan or my plan, it's going to be our plan that we're going to all build together, and Brian is going to tell you more about it in a few minutes. We have to build a culture of philanthropy. We're starting by enhancing and funding the advancement division, but also I'm working on the other side with the board of trustees and expressing what my expectations will be for them. That's another goal. Start eliminating silos. We start with the open house at the University College campus, and there are more work we're going to do internally. Any new facility that opens up, space opens up, I would like to see it being more of a collaborative space and a space that is shared by different schools versus this is my fort, nobody else is allowed to get in. And even new faculty requests, I would like to see more interdisciplinary appointments, maybe appointments from two schools or more. Also, we're going to begin implementing the Equity Action Plan that Ame has and her group has put together. And in building the team, we're going to hire a new provost for the university. We're going to have a national search, and I'll talk more about it. We're almost done on close finishing the search for an associate provost for our civic engagement programs and dean of the law school. So the provost search, we talked with a number of search firms. Yesterday we decided on hiring Storberg Pimentel. I've known them from the other side because they're trying to recruit me in the past for positions, and they're terrific. Also, they specialize they do a lot of work with prestigious small schools, so they have a good Rolodex with folks that are looking or they want them to look at other jobs. And also we picked the same firm for the law school and search and the provost search because they have experience with both, because there are economies of scale of them coming on campus and meeting with different groups for both searches. Also, they'll get to know the university well, and we won't have to bring up to speed two different search firms. We're beginning the process for faculty elected positions, so we're in conversation with the Senate. There will be very strong faculty representation in the search committee. I would like to have a small committee to make decisions and keep the process as open as possible. And that we have to listen to the advice of the search firm to see what's possible. Because at the very end, we do not want to lose candidates that they want to keep confidential their candidacy. So we'll push as much as possible to have it as open of a process. And it will depend on who the finalists are and how it works. I think the process that was used to hire me was great, because at the end it was a fairly open process. And I didn't say it's great because you hired me, at least from my it was great. There was a difference though, because I had decided to leave the museum by the time, and I had announced my departure of the museum by the time I started looking. And so I did not care if people knew that I'm a candidate. But there are other people that if they're sitting provosts or sitting deans in other schools, they may not want their candidacy to be exposed. So we'll see how that goes. Strategic planning process. So we're not going to do a strategic plan. We're going to do a strategic action plan. And Brian is going to tell you how we came to this decision and how this whole thing is going to pan out.
Good afternoon. So the spirit of how Yanis is talking so far about strategic planning and being more innovative and nimble in our processes is something that he asked me to think about when we think about strategic planning at the institution. And in the spirit of how we think about where we've been as an institution and where we're going, the first place I started when asked to think about planning is to look back at the history of planning at Roger Williams and the information that we have available to us. And what strikes you when you start to look at it and talk to people who've been here and been involved in planning is the first thing is that no plan at the institution has ever outlasted the president that initiated the process. They've been projects that are more individual, projects that were specific to that president. And then in the movement to the next president, you either had a reset or a new plan and didn't look back to honor the work that was done before them. And that history goes back at least to the 90s and the history that we've been able to look at and understand the documents and the path that we've taken. So honoring that and sharing that here a little bit, the plan for the 90s was where how we started the 90s. And the plan for the 90s lasted from 1990 to 1994, because that's sort of the span of the transition of the presidency at the time. A lot of great work, a lot of sort of core values that came out and initiatives that were identified. Some of them may look familiar. We call them different things now, but community partnerships and thinking about global, thinking about academic excellence and what makes us distinctive were there in those plans. It ended up, and it was a nice view book, I have it in my office, 96 goals, 354 objectives for the university to follow. You transition from that to President Santoro, who, as far as we know, worked without a plan. The focus was creating a law school, the focus was fundraising and philanthropy, but in terms of a written plan, there wasn't a plan for the 90s, plan for his tenure. And then that transitioned to President Nurschel and the plan for 2020, which is just months away for us. So there was a thin document that was the 20 objectives to achieve by 2020. We've actually achieved a lot of them in the tactics of the institution, but this is a 9-inch binder. So there were 24 task forces, 312 participants, and working really from the starting of this planning process in the early 2000s, but the heavy work 2004 to 2007, and many people working in different committees. For context, just again, and we're sitting a long time, just raise your hand if you were on one of these 24 task forces in the room. Okay. And for all the work, for 3 years of work in committee meetings and writing documents, to then have President Nurschel's transition and that work not move forward, that strikes me as what we want to do different in the planning process that we put in place now. And so, yes, I've read the 9-inch binder. If anyone's looking for good night reading, I recommend that full document. But we've taken that work. I've had help to pull all of these objectives into a spreadsheet so that we can inventory which things are still present, which things still matter to the institution to follow that we didn't follow up on well. And many of the things in there are still urgent, still important, and we need to act on them in a different way. So truly, Jan is talking about a strategic action plan is to not come up with another plan, but to move from strategy to action in as timely way as we can. So that was the challenge then of the transition from Nurschel to President Farish. And the Vision Project gave us some really strong goals, strong statements about the university the world needs now, and a direction for the institution, and a lot of great work across the institution and our commitment to affordability, CPC coming out through this time in these efforts. But we didn't bring them into the divisional work explicitly. And it was really a project of a vision without the tactics and the measures and the objectives tied to them in a traditional planning structure. So summarizing 30 years of planning, a number of presidents, plans that didn't transition, some plans that were very heavy on objectives but not giving a vision and a guide, and some things that were heavy on a guiding vision without the details tied to them. So thanks for asking me to do this, first of all. And how do we do it differently? So at a high level, what I wanted to share is that we don't need to reinvent the past. Part of that campus survey, I wanted to just highlight here, and you can see 70 to 80% or more campus consensus that these are still relevant. From you think these six goals of the Vision Project about we want to provide transformative educational experiences, and that received the highest number of support from the campus. But we want to have vision groups that look at the plan for 2020, understand the work that's important, understand the work that advances these goals that the campus still feels important, and bring that work forward into our awareness for everyone to map to our planning that we do across the campus. So as sort of the spirit of sort of a year of planning, at a high level, I'll share, and then we can answer questions at the end in the open Q&A. What we're trying to do is move from vision to action in as quick a way as possible. And versus one committee that meets for 3 years, we're trying to create some small groups that have sort of sprints of work, 6 to 8 weeks of a concentrated effort on a given topic with given tasks where you can go deep into the work and then build to the next step. So what we're mapping out is really phase one of really honoring the past, and vision working groups and faculty elections just happened recently for this, and we'll be populating these groups to look at this past work, to question the wording of the vision working goals, to think of how the tactics of the past can help advance them and bring them forward for us. And that work will help us answer this question: what really does the world need from a university now? You know, do we still commit to transformative and diversity and local and global communities and solving problems and thinking about affordability in different ways? So we'll spend that work that will then really need to feed to all the divisions of the institution. The spring work will focus on the business and operational plans of the institution, which everyone in the room needs to be a part of and be connected in how all of our plans integrate together. So how we take a vision plan and say, how does this affect our work in marketing? How does it affect athletics and student life? We have good momentum on different plans across the institution that we can feed and connect the work of the institution to the vision project very explicitly. Then that piece that Giannis talked about before comes in, linking planning to budgeting. This is where we need to go. This is the role that this unit can play, and we need resources to realize this vision and moving very quickly through that process. And then measuring, are we doing it well? So at a high level, from vision to action to operations to then measuring our work year over year is a sprint that we're trying to get to May. And this is what we've identified at the cabinet level and across the campus as the important plans that not everyone on campus has seen or been involved with. Some of these efforts are done, some are near completion. Some you can look at and know they've been very inclusive of the campus community, and others have been done within their integrated, within their own divisional area. So the challenge of Giannis asking us to break down silos is to understand how all of these plans are connected to each other. Our ASEM and our strategic enrollment process this last year underscores that we can't move with an enrollment plan without knowing the majors and the way that our schools are moving, and we need to be in dialogue with each other. But you can draw lines between all of these plans and the work that we need to do moving forward. And really a sense of integrated planning is where we hope to move through the course of the year ahead. And from the survey, this is the challenge of acting more nimbly, of not having one committee take 3 years to build a plan, but to move and ensure that planning is very action-based and happening across the institution and guiding our decisions, guiding our budget work and the time that we have together. So with that as just a high level, I'm glad to turn it back over to Giannis. There's a handful more Q&As that didn't fit the divisions that we'll go through and then turn it to full question and answers. And I'm glad to answer questions about planning at that time.
All right. So a few more of questions or statements from the survey about the university's identity. What is the identity of Roger Williams University? Who are we as an institution? What is our competitive advantage over other schools? Or what is the plan to figure out the answer to these questions? We're doing many things great. I think it would be a good move to consider moving closer to a teacher-scholar model. We are always going to be a teaching university, but I really believe that it will attract a lot better students if they think they're going to come here and partner with faculty in the generation of new knowledge. And so that's an area that we could build upon. Civic scholarship is a signature program here. As you know, we elevated the director position for the Civic Scholars Program to an associate provost position. I would love to see that become a requirement for all our students and differentiate us from other schools. Northeastern is known for its COA program, Roger Williams could be known for his civic engagement program as well. There are many more areas. Identifying scholarship and teaching areas such as coastal sustainability and investing in these areas and distinguish us from other universities, that's another way we could distinguish ourselves. On the morale area, for any institution to function cohesively, you need a positive vibe from all members of the university community. Unfortunately, many staff workers feel undervalued, way underpaid, and generally understaffed. Make your staff happy and they will in turn feel good about what they do. They are your best marketing tool. So morale is not just the job of the president or the administration. Everybody should work together to improve morale. When different entities of the university, different groups, are advocating for their particular group, they should take into consideration what effect that that advocacy and results will have for other groups as well. So that's an area that is going to take time to all of us, but to work together. But it's going to be a joint effort. Improving the budget situation, of course, will help morale. But there are a lot of other things that don't cost much money that affect morale. And some of them may be driven from administration, some of them may be driven from faculty, staff, one department to another department. And that's an area that we could all work together. And there are certainly some things that I can do to improve morale, and two small things were the children policy, the doggy policy, and there'll be more coming through. But the big morale issues, I think they're all of our responsibilities to improve, and I think we know what we should be doing here. Transparency and communication, that's another thing that came. When will there be more transparency between the upper leadership and the rest of the campus community? Communication in the last year has been terrible. Those of you that have spent time with me, you know that what you see is what I am and what you get. I say the same story to all the different constituencies, even the way we decided on this year hires was very open. I brought all the deans in one room today. They made their case. We made some quick decisions. We'll go back. But then every dean heard the case from the other dean. So there's nothing behind closed doors, no deals. It's all out in the open. And I'm committed to continue working like this with all the constituencies and make sure that all my cabinet members, all my team, does the same thing as well. Salos and collaboration. I would like to know how he intends on bringing this university together after it has been fractured apart. That is no department wanting to work together for the common good instead of only worrying and seeing their small part in this university. I think communication, better communication among divisions and programs can help a lot. As a small example, we're going to have this open house in Providence for the University College. It's up to the Bristol folks to attend. If they don't attend, then it's not going to work. So I think that everybody should make an effort to learn more about what the other entities do. And then all the suspicion and all this will eventually go away. And this does not refer only to Bristol versus Providence. It's even within Bristol. A lot more has happened. So we'll try to have a lot more collaborative efforts. On the sustainability area, can we elevate sustainability to a higher profile venue so it's on par with diversity and inclusiveness by establishing sustainability office or center with a staff person to coordinate and advance sustainability initiatives? One of the planning groups is going to focus on sustainability, so that could be somewhere we move. However, I see sustainability as a broader issue, ecological sustainability, human, economic health sustainability, well-being sustainability. So it's a broader term, and we cannot have an officer for every one of these elements. So we have to figure out first what we do in the traditional sustainability, the environmental sustainability area, and how we're going to make progress in that, but also think of the other sustainability areas as well. So these are some of the questions that we pulled off of the survey. And just to frame today's conversation, it's the beginning of a conversation. There are a lot more great comments on the survey that will my team and I will start working on and work with the deans and the faculty senate and the different staff constituencies to make things good. Overall, I was very pleased to see the engagement of the staff and the faculty through this survey. And people are really committed to making this place even better. And it's, I'm very optimistic. I think it's, we're on a great path, and we'll move forward. So let me take a few questions now, if you have any. Oops. I'll talk about that later. So, oh well, I'll tell you now anyway. So this is the question. One question is, what about having the week of Christmas and New Year's off to spend time with family and save on costs of the university being closed? And this question was asked by at least 7 different people. So, let's do it. So, we're going to have the week between Christmas and New Year's off. Now, there are some details that will follow from HR and union reps, because there are some people that will have to be here, but they will take the equivalent time off at different times. So everybody will have the total days off. If somebody has to be here, and you know who these people are, then they will take the 3 days off subsequently. So that's another small move. So any questions? Now everybody's happy that there'll be no questions. Any questions, anybody? Because we can move on. Okay, if there are no questions. So, when we collaborate, great things are happening. And look what happened with retention and enrollment. And amazing things happened just in 1 year that everybody worked together. Now, there are things we should work together in changing the culture. And we talked about morale, planning, budgeting, and philanthropy. And we're going to do this together. And I want to thank you. We have this fabulous publication over there that you can take home and enjoy. And thank you for coming and listening. And if you have any comments, you know how to find me. Just email me. Thank you.